Privileged to stand before you this morning to speak on a topic that says godliness and contentment is great gain. Godliness and contentment is great gain. Without wasting much time, can we go to the book of 1 Timothy? Herewith, contempt. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which draw men in perdition, and which draw men into harmful destruction and perdition. Amen. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some covet after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Hallelujah. Contentment is great gain. What is contentment? What does it mean when it says someone is contented? Contentment, what does it mean? We take a few definitions of this, then we look into the word properly. It is a state or a degree of being contented. A state or degree of being contented. Number two, happiness in one's situation. And satisfaction, happiness in one's situation and satisfaction. Amen. It is the neurophilosophical experience of of satisfaction and being at ease in one's situation, body or mind. To be satisfied with what you have. To be satisfied with what you have. To be satisfied with who you are at a time. To be satisfied with who you are at a time. To be satisfied with your monthly salary, your monthly income, your daily income or gain. Be relaxed and satisfied, to be contented with your monthly salary, your income, your gain, trying to build your expenses and all that around what you have. Many Christians, many of us, our salaries are not enough. Not because we don't have money to do some certain things, but because we want to do so many things. And because we want to do so many things and achieve many things, that which God has sent into our life, that which we have labored for an end, is not enough. Nothing is so distressing or when a man has worked for a whole 1 month and the pay, the salary for your sweat comes into your hand and it was not able to take care of your needs. It's so frustrating. It is so distressing. But you see, a wise man will build his expenses and everything based on his income, what he has. So this is what strives and sparks up greed. When what we have is not enough, when what we have is not enough, it becomes a problem. Amen. So I said, it is to be contented, you know, to be able to be satisfied with your income, your gain, not being greedy, or not satisfied with what you have, not wanting or fighting to by all means be like someone else, earn like someone else, save and amount wealth like someone else, not being covetous of other people's assets, not being covetous of other people's properties or possession, to be contented with what you have. When you cast your eyes on what others have and you strive to be like them, you create problem for yourself. Praise the living God. So a Christian should afford to be contented with his present income, not striving or fighting to be like someone else or own what someone else owns or possesses. Praise God. Now, please note this. Let me make this clear immediately. Note that that it is good to covet after good things. Praise God. Hello. It is good to covet after good things, but not with greed. Not with greed. The scripture said in the book of James chapter 4, I think in verse 3, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss, that you may, you know, consume it upon your lust. So when you see a Christian, thank God with the kind of prayer points that they raise in churches today. And when we come for prayer, they lead us into covetousness. By the time you finish praying, you leave that church not being satisfied with yourself, not expecting to see what God can do, what God can add to your life. But there are some certain things you have demanded and your eyes is cast out. They are waiting for these things to come. Whether they are the will of God for you or not the will of God. Sometimes we even ask for the things that we have not labored for. We ask for the things that we do not have assets that can bring them. What does it look like when a Christian begins to decree that I will build my house this year? Fine, it is good for us to practice faith. But we should be very careful about how we do these things, lest we cut, you know, we find ourselves into the snare of the devil. Praise the living God. Because, you know, to be greedy is to begin to expect something from where you have not sown. To expect to reap from where you have not sown. Many Christians are not just expecting, they are reaping from where they have not sown. And that's an expression of greed. They are not contented. So many Christians has not honored God because of their present income, because of their present job, because of what they have right now. They did not give thanks to God. Why? Because their eyes has been cast on things that shadows, that looks like shadows. Let me call it shadows. Christians pursue after shadows and you cannot catch shadow. Praise God. I say praise God. So because of this, they are not contented. They hardly say, Father, thank you for what you are doing in my life. Thank you for my present salary. Thank you for this. Thank you. They are not thankful unto God. God will give us the grace to overcome in Jesus' name. So like I said, it is good to covet after good things. It is good for a Christian to covet after good things, but not, you know, with worries and anxiety. Not with worries and anxiety, but to wait upon it patiently, especially when you have prayed concerning that particular thing, knowing that God is faithful and he answers prayers. We need to wait patiently. Praise God. I say, praise the living God. Hebrews chapter 10 from verse 35, he began to say, cast not, he said, away your confidence, which has great recompense of reward, that after you have done the will of God, that after that you have a need of patience, that after you have done the will of God, that you may receive his promise. Praise God. And he said, wait that he that shall come will come and will not tarry. When the time of your blessings comes, God will not withhold. God will not tarry. Your blessings will locate you in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the living God. So, I also want you to take note of this before we move on. I want to take note of this, that contentment is not laziness. Praise God. I say, praise God. Contentment is not what? It's not laziness. It is not lack of ambition. It is not lack of ambition. All right? It is good to have good ambitions. It is good to desire more good things and convert after good and nice things. So contentment is not laziness, and the Christian will go and sleep and say, well, you know, I'm contented with what I have, and then he don't have the spirit to sow anymore, to, you know, look for work, to go and work and, you know, try to see how he can gather some things to take care of it, pay his necessary bill, and you just go to sleep and say, you know, I'm very contented with what I have. So I put it to you that contentment is not laziness, and it is not lack of ambition. It simply, you know, means, or it is simply being happy with your position at a time, your result at a time, and your achievement at a time, while you look forward today to get better. Hallelujah. While you look forward for things to get better for you, you are patient, you know, waiting upon the Lord prayerfully, not trying to get it by all means. Praise the living God. That verse 6 says, contentment and godliness is great gain. Contentment and godliness is great gain. Those who are contented with what they have are peaceful people. A lot of people are in debt today because they are not contented with what they have. A lot of people have soiled their hands and put their hands into all kinds of things because they're not contented with what they have. Psalms chapter 37. Psalms chapter 37. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And I read verse 16. Psalm 37, verse 16. A little that a righteous man has is better than the riches of many wicked. A little that a righteous man has is better than the riches of the wicked. A lot of wicked people has done all kinds of things to get rich, including shedding of blood. They are known when they pass through the streets, people point finger at them. When they drive their big cars and pass, people point finger at them. People know how you made your money. They know. So, why you think you command respect? You have lost your respect in the society. But a person you consider a poor man that have integrity, they are highly, you know, recognized in the society and highly respected. Praise the living God. So the little that a poor man has is better. He is better in his position than a wicked rich man. Praise the living God. So you don't want to soil your hand. You don't want to spoil your name. You don't want to destroy your good name because you are not contented with what you have. That's what we see today. Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have, for he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So this tells me that Christians are not contented because they think that God has abandoned them. They think that God will not fulfill his promise. They think that, oh, if I fold my hands and continue to be a good Christian, I might end up poor. I might end up, you know, a pauper. I might not be able to pay my bills. So they are scared. They don't want to wait upon the Lord anymore. They go ahead of God. I don't know when this God will answer this prayer. So let me try and help myself. This has been the attitude of many Christians. Not like they don't want to continue to be a Christian. They want to continue to be a Christian filled with the Holy Ghost. But in the aspect of waiting for God or waiting on God, they have lost hope. May God restore the church. Amen. The Bible says, let your conversation be without covetousness. Praise God. Let it be without covetousness, especially coveting after worldly things. There is a lot for Christians to covet after. There's a lot for Christians to covet after. But you see, we covet after worldly things. Why? Because there is a lot of pressure around us. Your neighbor has just completed a mansion. Your neighbor that just bought a car. And you see, I am here trying to be a good Christian. See, my neighbor has removed the children from the same school they were with my children, and now their children in a better school, and the woman is putting too much pressure on the husband. And the child of God is losing his confidence in God. And the child of God is forfeiting and forgetting about the promises of God that I will never leave nor forsake thee. God will restore his church again in Jesus' name. Abraham. I want us to talk about Abraham that went to war to recover his brother and his family. And you know, in the process, they recover all that was carried away from Sodom and Gomorrah. And they returned. When the king of Sodom heard that Abraham has returned from war, he visited Abraham, and Abraham placed before him all that were taken away from Sodom and Gomorrah. And what he did was first remove one tenth of all and gave to Melchizedek and tied. And he pushed the rest back to the king of Sodom. And the king of Sodom tried to split the spoil and see how he can give some portion. Abraham said, no, I will not touch any of these things. He said, least tomorrow when God has blessed me, you say you are the one that made me rich. Christians has lost such virtue. Christians does not want to get rich and praise God and say, oh, it is God that have done this. Now, I want to challenge, if we have 100 rich men here, how many of them can come out and say, you know, boldly, oh, thank God, my riches, the foundation of my riches are based on Christ. And it was God that blessed me. No, it is difficult to see. Why? Because Christians think that by the time they lose the bribe that come to their table on daily basis, that when they have lost, you know, the opportunities to make wealth, they might not make it again. May God deliver the church in Jesus' name. After such a message on Sunday morning in my church, one of a brother came and said, sir, as I'm talking to you right now, 4 million naira is in my possession. I said, how did it happen? He said, the fuel they supply us annually, sometimes you know, we don't exhaust them. But what happened is that this, at the end of the day, they will tell us, you know, let us split the money, you know. And I was like, I can't remember if it's 4 million naira, but he told me it's a very huge amount of money. Praise God. I said, so what do you want to do? He said, that money is the abri. I said, you cannot touch that money. It is a cost money. You will have to choose Christ and Mammon. Praise God. That's what all I said. He nodded his head and said, thank you, sir. And he left. I trust that child of God. Praise God. The next morning, he do away with all that. He did away with all that. Your salvation is more important than the whole riches of the earth. No matter what you have or possess on earth, instead of sometimes they even give you sorrow, put you down. Many Christians have sold their salvation. Satan has taken their salvation and gave them wealth. And many are struggling to see how they can get in that position. I really want to cross that line. You see, I want to get out of this position. Nobody likes poverty. I don't like poverty. But I also prayed, God, every blessing, any blessing that you are not giving to me, may it be far away from me. That's my prayer. Praise God. What shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose your soul? Honesty has disappeared from the church because of greed and covetousness. God will restore the church again in Jesus' name. In verse 7, it said, for we brought nothing into this world and shall go with. This is what, even as the worldly people has forgotten this, Christians has also forgotten this. We're supposed to show them example. By being contented with what you have, by being satisfied with what you have. A member of our church said that when they are sharing bribe in the office, they don't come to his office. And when the money they are sharing is good one, it is the boss that will send for him. Praise God. The boss will go and call him. He will not collect. Call him. If you give him, he will not take. Call him. Let him come to my office. And when he comes to the office, he will stand at one corner. And the boss will explain. He will explain. You see, this money, this is how it's coming. And you know, we're supposed to. And when he look at it and everything is clean, he do what? He collect. If it is, there is not a discussion. The boss said, don't bother going. He will not take. He has been known for that. And because of it, they have been trusted. The most secret place of that place has been trusted into his hands. He has been distinguished among every staff because of his integrity. Have you sold your own? Can you represent Christ in the midst of money? Child of God. He said, don't bother going to his office, he will not take. And I trust that man. I know who he is. Praise the living God. In one of the days, he told me, he said, when they brought that money, all I have is not less than 2,000 naira. And they are bringing such amount of money and you reject them. God will rehabilitate his church again. In the mighty name of Jesus. For we brought nothing into this world and we shall take nothing away. Job chapter 1. Quickly. The book of Job chapter 1. And if you're there before me, you read verse 21. Job chapter 1, verse 21. Job chapter 1, verse 21. And said, naked I come out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken. The Lord gave, and the Lord has. We know who Job is. We know who Job was. The Bible told us that he was the richest man in the East. that Job was the richest man in the East. Satan was not able to possess him. Satan was not able to attack him because his foundation was built on God. He was righteously rich. Tell your neighbor, righteously rich. Many Christians are not righteously rich. He was righteously rich. In the midst of his riches, he still served God. When mammon possesses a man and gives him wealth, see that man, even though he's a pastor, watch him, he serves Satan. He serves Satan. His services are not unto God. He righteously served God in his righteous wealth. The Bible said that when his children goes out and come back, he looks at them. He said, peradventure, they have committed sin against the Lord. He will go and take some oxen or a sheep and whatever and slaughter before the Lord. And he knelt and prayed on their behalf. He was rich and mighty, the richest in the East, still serving God. But a day came into his life when his integrity has to be tested. If your integrity has not been tested, child of God, you still have a long way to go. Don't celebrate yet. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You are yet, if your integrity has not been tested, I tell you, you are yet to be a Christ ambassador. His integrity has to be tested. Satan came contending, and God said, go. Take away everything he has, but touch not his soul. Everything that Job has crumbled in how many days? In one day. Praise God. Now, the position have changed. Job, let's see how honest you are. Let's see if you are really a man of integrity. Because Satan said, God, if you remove everything he has, he will do what? He will curse you. That means he will disappoint you. In Job's affliction, in Job's persecution and trouble, even up to sickness and disease, that men begin to avoid him, Job never sinned against God. The wife said, don't enter the wife. You know who you used to be now. This is what you are. Curse God and die. And Job looked into her face and said, why are you talking like one of these foolish women? Was it not God that blessed me? And now that we're in this position, why should I curse God? I also heard that his friends who were rich visited him. We didn't see how he opened up a discussion channel. You know, you need to help me. You know, I was rich. We are friends. Now you have to help me. You have to do something. No, Job's attention and focus was upon who? God. Praise God. We have Christians today bending to sinners for help. And they are so surprised. That person that claims to know God more than me, coming for me for help. They are so surprised. And they quickly give you the help in mockery. They mock at you. They mock at your God. They give you the help. What you require, what you wanted. Go, they become a blessing to you. And you go out rejoicing and celebrating. You have just betrayed your God. You have just betrayed your God. Abraham said to the face of the king, I don't need these things. I have a God who has promised to bless me. I will look up to him. We go to offices. Somebody said it here. That a Christian has to change his name. And put on the name of infidels. In order to get a job. And they go to church. And give thanksgiving. May God have mercy upon the church. In Jesus' mighty name. Verse 8. Having food and remnant. Let us be contempted, praise God, Having food and remnants. Having food and remnants. Christians are committing sin because of food. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Are committing sin because of what? Because of food. We have Christian sisters putting serious pressure on their husbands. Not because there is no food at home, but because there is not what they consider to be good food. I've seen a Christian sister fought the husband because they have not eaten meat in 1 week. And she threatened to pack her things and go back to her father's house. She has so frustrated at home that ridiculed the husband, that the mother, her mother, when her mother goes to market to buy things, her mother will just cut like 300 naira meat and bring it to them. And she quickly cook it and then they eat the meat. And the husband is dying slowly. She embarrassed her husband. She embarrassed her God. She embarrassed the Church of Christ. Food. A sister came to me. I have a confession to make. I took her to the corner. I'm telling you because you don't know her. What is your confession? I committed adultery. You? She's not my church member. That's when we were doing outreach. Praise God. What happened? For 3 days, I and my children were drinking garri. You have garri in your house. Garri and sugar. That's how we put it. You have garri in your house. And you people drink garri for 3 days. You have garri at home. And because of that, a man that has been calling you, you flash him and he called you and gave you an appointment. Madam, how much did she give you? He said 10,000. I said, shame on you. Shame on you. I have to walk away from the counseling room, leaving her there. I have to go and clear my head before I came back. Throughout the counseling, I couldn't take a look at her face. Committed adultery for 10,000. There's garri in the house. Where is the money now? How long do you spend the money? It took her only 3 days to spend the money. They go back to garri. May God deliver the church. Now, this woman's case is like this. Many of us, I don't believe there's any one of us here, but many Christians have done this and kept silent. She had the seed of God in her. Praise God. I think that is what persuaded her to come and make confession. Many will do it and do what? Close your mouth. Because of food. What to eat. Jesus spoke to us emphatically in the book of Matthew chapter 6 concerning this. Turn your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 6. And then we begin to read. We read verse 11 first. Verse 11. What did he say? Give us this day our... Who was teaching here? Give us this day our... The next bread that you store up in the house will create temptation. It will bridge a gap between you and God. Take it. Anytime a man or a woman store food in the house, their prayer life for God's blessing for food ceases. Do you know why? They already have it. It's stored there in the house. So there's no need to pray. They don't depend on God. It is not the will of God in the beginning that we should build a particular house and stock food there. That is faithlessness. In the garden, Adam goes and plucks what he eats by the day. When the children of Israel were migrating, God rained manna down and warned them. Why would God say that? Why would God not say, okay, you can pack the one you can eat for 1 week so that he too, God, will rest and not try to rain manna again. But he has prepared it and designed man that he will feed man on daily basis. That is why he took them out of the environment of plenty, out of the environment of abundance, and put them
in the wilderness where there is no tree, no fruit, no vegetable, no carrot, no cucumber.
You see, there in the wilderness, they start, complaining, asking for cucumber. But God brought them here to feed them and to make them understand that He is able to feed them. Don't keep the one you will eat in the evening. Fetch the one for the morning. Do you know man in his ambition? Do you know what they do? They will gather the one for morning and evening and they will hid it somewhere. And by the time they go there, it has become worms. I am not saying it is not good for a Christian to store up food. If God has provided for you, thank God. But let not your mind rest and your confidence on your storehouse. Let it be in God. Be contented with what you have. If you are contented, I tell you, you can never come out and accuse God. Is there anybody here that will tell us whether you have a job or not? I stay from morning till night, no food. Can I have a witness? It simply means that you've coiled your leg one place and you did not stand up to go out. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Tell me that, oh, God failed me, that from morning to night I did not see food to eat. And I will tell you that you sat one place and you did not move out. That is why you did not find food. The faithfulness of God has been there for us. The fishes in the sea, the animals in the bush, everyone has something to eat by day. Jesus said again from verse 25, Matthew chapter 6, we begin to read from verse 25. Therefore I said unto you, take no thoughts for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not like the life more than meat, and body the remnant? Behold, the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, now gather into where? A lot of us have a lot of big barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? Which one of you, by taking thought, can add one cubic unto your stature? Now, let's stop it there. I discovered that amongst every creature of God, human beings are the ones that are with ambition, over ambitious. That's what man is. We are over ambitious. Now, God told the trees in their nature, stay here. Don't move out. Raining season, dry season, I want you to stand one place. I will feed you. I will clothe you. When it is time for your fruit, you will bring forth fruit. Trees obey God. That's why Jesus Christ refers us to the plants. Praise God. You plant a mango tree here, travel to US, come back in 20 years, that mango tree is standing there, trusting God, believing in God, that God will do what He said. Does it bother you that in the harshness of the weather, in the dry season, the leaves of the trees never withers? Praise God. Because even if rains refuse to fall, there is another arrangement God has made, the dew. And their leaves continue to be greenish because they trust in God. And when it is time for them to bring forth their fruit, God supplies their fruits. They bring their fruits proudly. They trust God. And faithfulness of God has never failed them. Hallelujah. But human being has refused to trust God. We don't know what has become of Moses and his God. Make us another God. Make us another God. Man has always gone again, after other gods. But in things that has to do with food also. A lot of people that are in a occultic world today, they want to eat good food. May God have mercy upon the church. May God rehabilitate his church. May God heal his church in Jesus' name. Verse 9. Those that will be rich, those that will be rich, fall into temptation. Praise God. Can we go back to that scripture? 1 Timothy. If you're there, read verses for me. 1 Timothy chapter 6, read verse 6 for me. Sorry, verse 9. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Verse 9. But they that will be rich falls into temptation and a snare. And a snare. And into many foolish and harmful lusts, which draw men into destruction and perdition. Many who have appetite for richness, to be rich, many that wants to be rich, they fall into temptation, they fall into perdition, they fall into destruction. They come to a place where the, you know, their relationship with God has been broken, their bridge has been cut off, a line of perdition. They are a type of, you know, Judas. A type of Judas. They draw it themselves into perdition. They turn themselves against God. They rebel against God. How can a man be alive and he already know the day he will die? Sorrow. Sorrow. In Lagos, when they finished building Auto Pass Market, that's one of the biggest auto pass market in Africa. I was very close because they draw some wisdom from us. The elders, they ask us questions. And then, so we got very close to them. At the ending of that, they organized a big party in which they, through which they want to initiate us into cult. Praise God. I said, praise God. I did not attend that meeting. And so that some of them that went, when they came back, oh, they said what we saw. Oh, they gave them many things and they prepared grant for them and all that. Nobody said anything to them, but they showed them things to draw them out. Praise God. And at the end of the day, we later have one of them on quarry. He became so rich, riding big cars and everything. And one of the days, he drove into the filling station with his big Jeep. And I drove into the filling station with my all car is car, praise God. And then, so when we step out of our cars and I said it at him, I said, are you? He said, immediately I set my eyes on him. It is not him I was seeing. He's gone. To shake his hand irritated me. Praise God. I greeted him like this. And I drew close to him. I said, now you're rich. You have money. You have everything. So how is life? He put his face down. When he raised it and looked at me, his eyes was red. That action alone spoke about many things. I waved my head. I didn't have anything to tell him. He has already crossed the line of perdition. Praise God. He has already sold his soul to the devil. What did the Pharisees say to Judas? See thou to? Eh? See thou to it. It's your business. Praise God. I said, praise God. Those that will be rich, they will draw themselves, they will be drawn into perdition. James. Okay, I think we should see the book of Proverbs, chapter 15. Proverbs chapter 15. Proverbs chapter 15, if you're there before me, read verse 27. Proverbs 15, 27. Can you read again? A greedy man will bring what? Trouble to his family. Praise God. I say, praise God. A greedy man will bring trouble to his. There's one man, a 419 man, living behind our house before. Every time you see him jumping the fence, his wife had learned how to jump the fence. His children are not with him. Praise God. The children are not living with them. But the wife, even in her wrapper, once she touched the top of the fence, she landed the other side. They have trouble. I said to myself, why is this man troubling his family? This scripture have explained it all. He's always on the run. Always on the run. Sometimes, another individual will knock the gate. They will skip the fence. Praise God. God will not allow us to run. In Jesus' name. James. Okay, I think we'll see the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 19, verse 21. Matthew 19, 21. Yes.
If thou would be perfect, go and sell all that you have and give to the poor. And thou shalt have treasure in heaven.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Now we know the story. Jesus said to him, go and sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. What did that young man do? He walked away sorrowful. Praise God. He walked away sorrowful. Why did he walk away sorrowful? He wanted to be a disciple of Christ. He wanted to serve God. He wanted to make it to heaven. But now you're telling me to sell all I have and give to the poor? So he became sorrowful. He wants to make heaven, but it's difficult for him because of money, earthly possession. Because of earthly possession. May God have mercy on us. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 8 to 9. Proverbs 3. 8 to 9. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 8 to 9.
Honor the Lord with all your health, with the first fruit of your crops.
Praise God. Okay, let us move on. Verse 10. Verse 10. For the love of money is what? For the love of money is the root of all. Well, the love of money is the root of all evil. Many Christians, like I said, have soiled their hands, you know, because of money. Many has given their soul to the devil because of money. Young men engaging themselves in cultism, and those that are in the church not being honest, you know. Many take bribes. They destroy, they take and give bribe. They destroy their good names. Destroy the name of God and destroy the name of Jesus, which they carry about. The Jesus they represent. So many Christians are under the influence of Mammon. Even up to today. Under the influence of Mammon. Even up to today. And many are still under the pressure. Under serious pressure to do all manner of evil just because of money. To do all manner of evil just because of money. You can imagine how much Mammon has eaten up the church. Even though Christ warned us in the book of Matthew chapter 6 verse 24. You cannot serve God and... But Mammon has taken the church, taken head of the church. Mammon has taken integrity from pastors and give them money. Mammon has taken, you know, the place of anointing. You have taken anointing. The truth has been sold for money. Ministers of God, Satan watches you. When he sees your ambition and your hard work, he will send a rich man to your church. When you see how much you're preaching the truth and how much you want to remain preaching the truth, he sends rich people to your church. We've seen pastors bowing to, The rich man in the church. Because he's the one that brings the what? He's the one that brings the money. If he doesn't bring money, you will not do that big program. Must you do a big program? Must you do a big program? Many pastors, since they became rich, they no longer evangelize again. When they were not rich, they evangelized, they win souls, they were happy. But now, that happiness has been taken away. The happiness they have now is the happiness that money brings. Praise God. May Satan not hijack your church. I am telling you, you need to see what ministers of God are doing on the pulpit right now. They consequently serve mammon. Serve mammon. A big crusade was organized recently in our area. And on the day of the crusade, I took my Bible. I said, my wife, let me go to crusade. On getting to the crusade, the so-called bishop, when they call him, if you see the way he was introduced, the army of God, the angel of God, and they call him all kinds of names. And this was advertising the product he has to the people. And when he came up and took microphone, I said, yeah, let me, now I will get blessed. Let me hear the word of God. He quickly rushed into telling the story of Jesus and tell one fake story of how somebody, Christians, who refused to carry Jesus in their car, Americans, they put an egg in the boot and put Jesus in the boot. And when the car somersaulted, all of them died. But the egg in the boot with Jesus was saved. After telling that story, he senses like people are not. He told them, don't worry, I'm coming up with prophecy now. And before you know it, this man began to behave like a child. I picked my Bible and I went out with tears in my eyes. As I was going, I was controlling myself so that people would not notice that I'm crying. As I was going, tears were flowing from my eyes. Money spent, people gather. He began to display. The next day, come and see crowd. They will give you form, you feel before you go in to see him. Why? He'll call you, come. He'll tell you what happened. This is covetousness. We once organized a conference, End Time Eternity Conference. People came and they got blessed. In that conference, people gave their life to pastors. See, altar call was made. Pastors, you are not born again, come and give your life to Christ. I saw something that day. Pastors came and was rolling on the ground. They gave their life to Christ. When we proposed the next one, because the chairman is gone, the new person said, they said they want the kind of conference that they want to be like a Adeboye, you know, Oyedepo, you know, conference that will make their church grow. You know, they need some. And that proposal were thrown into the trash. Covetousness. Covetousness, not being contented with what they have. For the love of money is the root of all. For the pastor to call you and tell you to sow seed that God said you should sow seed. And he knew that he is lying. He's not saying the truth. And why will he do that? Because he knows that you too, you are very, very greedy. You are greedy. You want to reap where he did not sow. You are not contented with what you have. So he sees his opportunity to exploit you. To take from you and add to the one he has. They are smarter than you are. If a Christian should sit at home and pray unto God, go for counseling. If you find you are facing serious hardship, go for counseling. Talk to pastor. This is what I'm going through. And then if your pastor is a true pastor, he will pray with you and give you some level of confidence, you know, and your hope and your faith will come back alive. You see, you will never wither. The Bible said that we shall be like a tree that is planted by the rivers of, praise the living God. That's the promises of God. Take no counsel from the ungodly. Most of those people you run after, they are ungodly men. They are into the Bible said, those whom God is their what? Their belly. They are in church for what they can get. They are not contented with what they have. They just want to explode. They want to, you know, build 1,000 capacity, 100,000 capacity and more. That's the ambition. No, there's no thought of going to heaven. There's no thought of, so many of them, ask them, they will not tell you that yes, there is heaven. Many pastors don't believe there is heaven. Hello? Yes. Do you know why they lost their faith? They could not stand the trials of life, the challenges of life. They prayed and prayed and prayed for God to change their position. And God from heaven is saying, it's not time. You are not matured enough. Pray more. Study more. Walk more. It is not time. I promise not to fail you. I will bless you, but pray more. At the time, they said, I'm tired of praying. How am I even sure God is hearing my prayer? How am I even sure? These were not spoken by words. In their thoughts, they concluded, I'm not too sure. Well, I'm already a pastor. I will continue to be a pastor, but I think I need to do something. And you know what? They have deviated from the ways of the Lord. Covetousness, greed. We brought nothing into this world, and we shall not live here with anything. Before I round up this morning, I want to tell us a little story about the wisest and the richest man of the Bible, Solomon. Once was humble, once was, you know, wise. Solomon, what do you want me to do for you? Solomon said, give me wisdom to rule this great nation. And God said, because you have not asked for wealth, because you have not asked for the head of your enemies, I will give you what you are asking for, and I will also bless you. I will give you wisdom. None shall be as wise as you are. In wealth, none shall be as worthy as you are. And God blessed Solomon. And God blessed Solomon. And Solomon began to build the house of God. But do you know what happened in the midst? Those that will be rich will fall into temptation and pierce themselves with sorrow. Solomon began to build the house of God. And when he finished building the house of God, he turned aside and started building house for Ashtoreth and other gods. Why? Why? He married the most beautiful women, but he was not contented. Satan will tempt you with your weakness. That is why the Bible says, put off the old man. If you are once a man that is greedy of money, when you get born again, put off the old man. If you're the type that is never contented, when you get born again, put off the old man. Otherwise, if you suppress the old man, it will gradually rise again. So the weakness in Solomon rose, that he began to look beyond the daughters of God, the daughters of Zion. He began to look beyond the daughters, the beautiful daughters of Zion, who are qualified. God has given them grace. He can marry as many as he wants. And he began to look beyond them. And he began to look into the other countries that serve other gods. And he coveted after their daughters. And he began to marry them. Oh, you know, if I will marry you, I have to come with my God, though. You know, I have my own God, though. He said, don't worry, you can come. And he goes to the parents and proposes, I want to marry your daughter. Well, we are ready to give you our daughter, but you allow him to go with one of our gods. You know, many of them have many gods. And they give one of them, and they put it in the bag, and they come. And you have to build a house for my God. And go and build a house for his God. Her God. There's money. There's money. And his spirit left God. Many Christians that God allowed to be rich has also failed God with what they do with their money today. There's money. Praise God. I said, praise God. I have a man, a friend, he was a knight. A knight in a Catholic church. His ambition was to sleep with like Liberian girls, American girls, whatever. So whichever place they are going, they call their agents to arrange for these things there. They pay cash. That's money. That's money. Money will stop a lot of people from making heaven. May you not be that person. Solomon coveted after strange women and built house for Ashtoreth and other gods, and then turned his back on God. But do you know what happened? God is a merciful God. I said, God is a merciful God. One day, Solomon was walking on top of the house, looking at his ranch, all he possesses, all he owns, his family, children and wives and concubines running up and down. And he was looking at these things. At a time, something struck his heart and tell him, one of these days, you will die and abandon these things. And immediately sorrow entered into his heart. I guess he would have remembered his father, who was a lion. You know, he never fought a battle. His father, who was a lion, who fought 36 wars and cleared 136 wars. There are so many things that that man did in the battlefield that Bible recorded. How he was able to dodge a heavy spear, hold it in the middle and bent it. He said that Lord taught my hands, that my hands can bend the bows of iron. Praise God. After thinking about these things, he says, so my father later died. So one day I also will die. Sorrow entered into his heart. And he begins to cry. The richest man of the world, the wisest man of the world, the most glorious king. People pay, kings travel for 6 months, selling in the water just to come and hear his wisdom. This man began to cry. What would have made a man of such great stature to cry? He remembered that one day he would die. Do you know what he said? Vanity upon vanity. It's vanity. Vanity. That he cursed the day he was born. He said, curse be the day it was announced that a baby boy was born. That day is cursed. I would have preferred if I died the day I was born. It's so, for as it is with the old, so it is with the young. Whether you die old or young, that was his conclusion. It doesn't matter. The sorrowful thing there is that you will die. Because of the possessions, the things he had, at this point he looked up. For a long time he has not looked up. He looked up unto God and he cried. And God in his mercies visited him. And there was repentance. He looked at all the wealth. He called them what? Vanity. He reduced everything to what? Vanity. I tell you, it is vanity upon vanity. Job said, I come to this world empty and naked. I shall return definitely with nothing. 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 So, why would you gain the whole world and lose your soul? It was after that encounter that Bible began to call him a preacher. Praise God. He began to preach. One of his preachings, as I remember, was what it means to serve God is worship God if you are alive. If you see something good, do what? He said, that is the only possession. That is the only gain. Your joy of serving the Lord and of eating something good. That's not different from the preaching of Jesus. Give us this day. Child of God, we're going to pray right now. Please, I like you to pray. We're going to rise up and talk to God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Many things are in place to make you lose your place. Many things, as I'm talking to you right now, are happening to make you lose your place in God. But you are going to rise up and stand your ground. No matter what happened, no matter what comes my way, no matter what I see, no matter the challenges, no matter the tribulation, may I not lose my path. May I not lose my stand with you, oh God. Open your mouth and begin to pray in the name of Jesus. Talk to God. They fall into snare. That's trap of Satan. They fall into snare. Trap of Satan. They fall into snare. They pierce themselves with many sorrow. They long to have what they don't have. They trouble their hearts. They trouble their soul. They are not thankful unto God because they are greedy and covetous. They are not contented. They are not happy with their position. They are not happy with what God has made them to be. They pierce themselves with many sorrow. Satan is lying in wait. Mammon is lying in wait. Please pray. Pray right now, child of God. It is the same wise man that said, give me not wealth, neither give me poverty. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and remnant, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich falls into temptation and snare, and into many foolish and lustful lusts, which draw men into destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which why some covet after they have erred. Have you erred from the faith? In the place of your business, have you erred from the faith? Pastor, concerning church money, have you erred from the faith? When people gather money and give you to do work in the house of God, you convert it. You convert it into your own money. Have you erred, Pastor? Sister, have you erred? It is time to cry unto the Lord. Cry for mercy. Cry for mercy. Cry for mercy. Cry for mercy. Ask God the grace to stand in this trying time. The Bible says in the book of James chapter 1 verse 12 that as many that overcome, they that overcome, they will wear the crown of glory. They that will overcome trials of temptations, tribulations, lack, there is a crown of glory waiting for them. Or what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and then loses his soul? We brought nothing into this world, certainly we shall carry nothing out. The Bible told us in the book of 1 John chapter 2, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. It says when you love the world, the love of the Father will not be in your heart. Jesus said you cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve God and mammon. In one of Jesus' teaching, he said, make wealth for yourself in heaven, where moth nor rot cannot destroy it. Ask God for the spirit of contentment, for you to be contented, serving God, waiting the coming of the Lord.
Words of love.